So today I'm talking about child language broking in schools, which was a project that was supported by the Nuffield Foundation. I'm Sarah Crafter, or Crafter, depending on how northern you are. And some of you may know the name of Tony Klein, who's got a long history of studying bilingualism and EAL. So he was the project lead. And we've been working together for a long time, and our researcher was Evangelia Procopiou. So in summary, what does child language brokering mean? Because it really sums up the notion of children who are either young translators or young interpreters, which of course is not a new phenomenon. Children have been doing that for centuries and have been supporting their families to do it. But we use the term child language brokering to denote a series of quite nuanced activities that children undertake whilst they're translating and interpreting. So they mediate between two languages. They often do it on behalf of family members and or peers or the local community. And quite importantly, they find themselves doing this activity in settings where they have to interact with officialdom, officials, professionals, and they often do this from quite soon after they have arrived and from quite early young ages as well. So unlike the kind of professional interpreter who is independent and impersonal, supposedly, and translates word for word as much as possible, a child language broker generally is there to support someone, and the person that they're generally there to support is their family. So they're not just, you know, like a professional interpreter. They mediate culture, they mediate linguistically, and they're often there to protect the interests of their parents or their families, because they find themselves doing this in places such as immigration offices, social welfare offices, and etc. So they go beyond the spoken word. That's the really key thing. Just a little bit of a background on where it occurs. So the majority of the research under the kind of child language brokering framework has been done in America. It's been done in the US. They broker, and you probably all know this anyway, in so many different places: doctors, dentists, healthcare settings, shopping, retail, police situations. They speak to banks, they speak to credit card companies. They have unfortunately been known in the past to have been translating to report that their own parents are being deported, all sorts of really quite serious situations. But one of the most common places that the literature in the US suggests that children do this is in schools. So that's one of the biggest cited sites that the language brokers themselves say that it takes place. Particularly, survey evidence from the US suggests they translate notes and letters most for their parents, documentation, and of course lots of face-to-face meetings. But up until this point, there had been no research in the UK, and particularly looking at school. So that's where we hope to fill that gap. I'm going to try and speed through my talk a little bit quickly because I know we're running out of time, so I'm going to skip some slides, just so you know. From a professional point of view, such as some of you of teachers, there has been quite a understandable resistance to using child language brokers in schools. Well, you know, you're worried that maybe they're not competent enough, that maybe they will misinterpret something. There's concerns about using children in sensitive situations. They might make mistakes, and there has been some reports of this activity being quite stressful on children as well. But on the other hand, and this is perhaps a practical reality, getting a professional interpreter into school for every interpreting situation is just not possible. Apart from being very expensive, it doesn't always work very well. So, yes, children are cheaper and they're quicker and they're easier and they're more accessible, but that's not the only story or the only part of the story. For many reasons, parents and grandparents often prefer to use their own children. For many reasons, children prefer to do the practice themselves. They feel very proud to help their families. They just see it as a normal extension of their caring responsibilities. My family needs me. It's what I do. It's how I help. They're more accessible, right? They're there. You're in school. They're there, so you can use them. They're more likely to understand what their relative requires. They know their parent. They know what their parent understands or doesn't understand about school. So they're handy in that way. There's sometimes with professional interpreters worries from families about the confidentiality of community or professional interpreters. Whether there's a basis for that in reality is not really important. A lot of families have that impression, and that's why they prefer to use their own children, because they know that they'll maintain confidentiality. So they may feel that they can maintain a bit more control. As a project group, one of the things that we were quite fascinated in was this notion that Valdez came up with, which is the idea that the child and the parent act as a kind of performance team together. So if you imagine them going into a legal office or a law firm to sort out some kind of case on behalf of their parents, and we've been interviewing language brokers, yes, they do go in and they help sort out their parents' divorce issues, all sorts. They are there advocating on behalf of their parents. You know, they're there to support them. And as such, are arguably a performance team. There's also marvellous examples of like students, pupils in a their parents own a Chinese restaurant, and they go, I don't even tell my parents what's going on. I knew what the fire and health inspector needed to sort out, you know, the certificate. I just sorted it all out myself. So yeah, but it is a really a big challenge for schools. I think probably. Preaching to the converted, you already know about this, and part of it is rapid changes for some of you to the kind, how many languages and the turnover of languages within your school as well. And the other thing, when we set out on this project and we tried to search for official schemes or guidance or policy guidance on using young translators, language brokers, interpreters in school, we could find so little. There was so little on Ofsted, and there was a little bit from the official support from the QCA, and Scotland has more sort of guidance than England. But other than Hampshire Borough Council, who run a young interpreter scheme, we couldn't find much around guidance for schools. So part of our project was, can we gather enough data in order to write up some guidance for what schools can do when they use child language brokers? So our study, shall I just tell you? Yeah, so this is what we found and what young people told us they had done in terms of child language brokering in school. And our study used both, we actually spoke to young adults, so anyone from the age of 15 up to the age of 26, so they're more looking slightly retrospectively at their school age times, and also we spoke to teachers, and we surveyed both of those groups as well. I'm going to skip this school, which talks this slide, which talks about how school is kind of different or special from other settings. One of the reasons why school might be quite different, going back to this idea of being a performance team, that the parents are there in the lawyer's office and the child supporting the parent and they want the best for their parent. School, maybe not so much. You're there at a parent's evening. you have maybe different interests, your own personal interests that might compete with school interests, right? So this is why we thought maybe school is a slightly different or special case in terms of looking at different contexts where children broker. Are they really a performance team? In that sense, children might be the sort of key main stakeholders or representatives of that. And children might not want to expose too much of their school life to their parents. You know, it's their thing. It's a separate thing, and they might want to keep it a separate thing. So it's also a sort of case of managing that situation. So, just very briefly, the aims of our projects were to provide this guidance for schools, which we had struggled to find any information on. If you guys can provide that, that's really great, but we hadn't managed to find anything. And use our evidence base to put that together. These are our research questions, and I can't deliver all of it to you. We have a website, we have a final report, I can provide that, and I've got a few handouts as well, so you can look at that for yourself. So I just wanted to kind of give you a sort of snippet of some of our findings and a little look at the guidance to see what it looks like, to show you what it looks like. And then hopefully that's enough. So one of the things that I wanted to talk to you about was question four, this idea that they might have their own interests that don't align with their parental interests or the school interests of what they want to do. And in our survey, we presented the teachers and young people with a series of vignettes and asked them to rate how much they agreed or disagreed on certain indications. And these are our most perhaps disparate differences of opinion represented here. So the percentages refer to those who agreed very like or that is like or very like how I am or how we experience it. So let's say, for example, responding to vignettes 1 and 2, Mandeep and Tolu, there are higher proportions of teachers than child language brokers that assumed what was said in meetings was either paraphrased to achieve an effective understanding or to save time. So the teachers thought there was a lot more paraphrasing going on than the language brokers reported that they did themselves. And I think partly the reason that is because they go home and fill in a lot of blanks from parents' evenings that they can't fill in there. So from their perspective, they've said everything, they just haven't said it then. So there's a sort of slight difference, I think, we think, in opinion about that. So more teachers than language brokers reported on family teamwork, but also that the language brokers gave the impression, teachers thought that the children were more in charge of the situation than children felt themselves. You know, this is this idea of role reversal between parents and children because they have a bit more power. The language brokers didn't report feeling that strongly in favour of that notion, even if that's what it looked like to teachers. As far as they were concerned, their family were in control of the situation, even if they're brokering for them, for example. Sometimes as well, motivations for why you would broker what you do, there's a lot of concern about whether pupils lie. Have they told the truth? Have they really told the parents what we told them to say? Now, this may be idealistic of the language brokers because they're telling us and they've got an audience, but most of them said that they would not lie in case they were found out later. And reported instances of, thank God I didn't lie, because it came up later in time and that would have been a bad. But on the other hand, at moments where they did bend the truth, they considered to be a moral decision that they were in favour of. Yeah. So some of it was self-preservation, but some of it was, I just don't want to upset my parents. So, you know, it's still a lie, But from their perspective, they perceive it as, I didn't want to upset my mum and I knew it would. So, you know, there's a sort of interesting set of issues. So let me just, within the last 5 minutes, okay, just tell you about our guidance, which we didn't want to be prescriptive with the guidance because we're really well aware that schools differ so much. And how the pupils feel about their language brokering within schools depends very much on the makeup of the school and how it's situated and where it's situated. So really what we wanted to do was almost more present a series of questions that teachers could ask themselves. And it sort of fell into these, the guidance falls into these categories. One principally being, when should you absolutely not use a child? That is kind of clear cut in terms of presenting our guidance. Things around choosing the best person, training young interpreters in a formal scheme, and things that parents and family members and teachers can do to make that situation a bit easier. We came across a few situations where young language brokers told us about some quite serious situations where they were brokering, for example, when police came to the school. I think it's quite fair to say that that shouldn't happen. So, you know, that what one teacher told us, I think it's not fair to ask a 15-year-old if you think they've got emotional issues. You wouldn't ask the child to say, can you talk with your parents about that? You know, there are some things that you don't ask a child to discuss with their parents. Inez was someone who said, I felt like I was exposed to things I wouldn't expose my own 7-year-old to. No way. Now, her case was quite unique because she not only brokered a lot at school, including having to broker in a situation where she was being bullied, and had the bully in the room, so a really sensitive situation. But she was also brokering at police stations that involved situations where her mum was experiencing domestic violence. Putting all those situations she experienced together culminated in her hating this activity. It was really unusual. All but her of our participants had a great deal of pride, and especially on reflection, were really proud to have done the activity. But if life's really tough for some of the kids, then it's tricky. So what's quite interesting, I think, as well, is what teachers and what the children thought of as sensitive situations that they wouldn't want to broker for, but they found a sensitive situation. Picking GCSEs and A-levels was not something that occurred to the teachers that the kids might find sensitive issue, but it was. So it's quite interesting to look at what is considered sensitive or serious. I think I'm going to leave you because I think we very much have run out of time. Just to give you an idea about students' complex feelings about acting as a language broker, because it's possible to both feel really proud of your language skills and at the same time feel a bit tense in case you get things wrong. But that's okay if you're in a supportive environment where it's carefully monitored and people know what you're doing. So, you know, and a lot of them talked about how, so Cara, for example, said, it sounds like, you know, it was more normal for me, and talking to us has refreshed my memory, how crazy I was as a child, and I kind of feel ashamed that I was actually embarrassed about my parents. But in the end, she reflected on how proud she was to have been a language broker in school. I think what I will do is kind of leave it there on a positive quote from someone who said, at the time I felt like I was nothing at all, but now I sit down and think about it, and I realise I'm doing something, I'm making myself better by language brokering. And it's a big thing, and it's a great opportunity, and it's great work that you're doing. So that's sort of finishing on a positive note of someone who went from feeling really insecure, but through their language brokering felt really, really positive in the end. Sorry, that was a bit rushed.
That's okay. Brilliant, thank you.